and something messed up and something broken.
Yes.
Something that other people would deem as unworthy.
Yes, Lord.
It takes it, it picks it up, it fixes it, and it sets you free. Just on the way to church this morning, after we parked up, I saw a man. He was rummaging through the bins. Now, everyone else walked past the bins. But that man in his mind, he was a homeless man, but that man in his mind had a perception that if he kept looking in a rubbish place, that there were some things that he can still find useful. That you and I might not see it. Now, I'm not saying God is homeless, but I believe that man has the same kind of mindset as God. See, for most of us, people walked past us, they left us, they abandoned us, but he kept on rummaging through it. See, the word salvation comes from the word salvage. To take something which otherwise should be thrown away. And if you are truthful with yourself, you will say, you know what, if it was a different God, you should have been thrown away. After all the mess you've done and after all the things you've done, you've been through. But God says that I can find something useful. That out of this mess, I can do something beautiful out of it. So that's why when we worship God, it shouldn't be from a religious standpoint. It shouldn't be from a I'm folding my arms standpoint. Grace has a sound. People have been touched by the grace of Jesus. They look, I tell people there's no way you can get hit by a truck and still look cute. There's no way. And I told you guys that story before. Someone walked into the office and said they were late for the interview because they got hit by a truck. If you got hit by a truck, you wouldn't turn up for the interview. Only your teeth and your bones would turn up for the interview. Let me tell you something. When the Bible says die to self daily, that means that you're saying I'm accepting the grace of God daily because I've been hit by grace. When you've been hit by grace, the things in you that are not useful for where God's taking you, they get shredded, they get broken off. Some of us, we have too much cuteness to really declare grace. We've got too much religion. I think some of us are too Christian to have grace. Seriously. I'm looking at the world around me and it's not sinners that make me upset no more. It's religious Pharisees that make me upset. Grace is real. Grace is real, is real, is real, is real. Don't clap on my account because I'm saying something. But grace is real. Grace is real. Tell your neighbor, grace is real. And as the words of the song says, God, I believe, I trust that you will make something beautiful. I was saying to some of the guys on Thursday that line is literally for the past few months has been my prayer. Just that line. I'm not trying to exegete any kind of big words or anything like that. I'm just using that line. God, that I trust you. That you will make something beautiful. Because I look over my life and I'm like, this is messy. I look over my struggles, I'm like, this is messy. But I trust that you will make something beautiful out of me. Come on, if you're in this room right now, you know that God is making something beautiful out of you. I want you just to shout me down this morning. Come on. Just. Hallelujah. I trust that you make something beautiful out of me. Father God, we love you. We love you. We really love you. Sometimes we feel unworthy to run to you, but we know that's the best place to be. You're a safe place. You're a gracious place. You're a loving place, a redeeming, a releasing, a miracle place. So Father God, all we want to say this morning is, Father God, that we are so blessed and privileged to have a place to run to and to hide. Whenever life gets weary, whenever we feel broken, whenever we feel alone, whenever we feel rejected, we know that we have you to run to. So we pray right now, Father God, that every single person in this room, every single person who's watching online, Father God, that they will be touched by your grace and they will hear the voice of your Holy Spirit. That your voice, God, will supersede every other voice in their lives right now. That young girl who feels that she has to sell her body to live, to make a living and to feel worthy, we pray that your spirit will speak to her right now, Father God. That man is about to pick up a gun and take another life, we pray that your spirit will speak to him right now, Father God. That man is about to shoot himself up with heroin, Father God, we pray that you will speak to him right now. That young woman was about to slit her wrist, Father God. We pray that your spirit will speak to her right now in the name of Jesus. Move in this place, Father God. Let your wonders manifest, God. We love you, God. And we are so grateful for you. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Good morning. Good morning. It's so good to see you guys. I am ready to literally get a ball rolling with part two of the Grip series.
Yeah, amen.
But what I want you to do right now, we're gonna, you know, as custom in this church, we're gonna put 2 minutes on the clock. I want you to find a new person, somebody that you didn't walk in there with today, and say hello to them, say hi to them. Guys, 2 minutes, please, all right? Like, literally 2 minutes. Last week was like 10 minutes. 2 minutes, amen. Can we do this?
Yeah.
All right, someone that you don't know. All right, let's do this. Amen. You're awesome. Thank you so much. That's heavy. Let me grab.
This mountain with my heart wide open.
Climb this mountain with my head wide open.
Bless you, my man. Bless you, man.
Thank you, God.
God's empowered surging through you, man, the Holy Spirit. Just completely run with it.
I lean not on
my
of heaven. Maker of heaven.
My life is in your hands.
Amen. Amen, church. How are we doing this morning? Is everyone good? Wow, one person's doing good. Wow. Is everybody good this morning? All right. Praise God. May we stand as we read. Who was there last week?
Yeah.
Who watched online? Praise God. Yeah, there was no live stream last week. But it was YouTube last week, though. We shared a video on YouTube.
Yeah.
One person.
Yeah.
All right. Two people.
Wow.
Going once. All righty, y'all. So last week, we kicked off a new series called Gripped.
Yeah.
All right. It's called a Grace series. And I like talking about grace. Couple of disclaimers this morning. Stormzy's album came out. And now, those who know this, that, we've been trying to get some connections with that dude. All right, because I'm trying to bring him here to interview him. All right, I don't need to bring a bishop here to interview them. I wanna bring people who will live my story.
Yeah.
All right. So I'm up at 4 o'clock in the morning, starting my prepping for today. And I'm listening to Blinded by Grace, part one and part two. And I'm like, I'm gonna share this on social media because, you know, if I like something, let me share it. All right, I know this guy's story and most of you guys don't know my story. My story isn't his story. And I put on social media and people were talking about it. And then this morning, the religious folks woke up. They only come out on Sundays, like. They didn't put my name on it, but they say like, oh yeah, that pastor is endorsing Stumzy.
Oh.
Yes, I do.
Yeah.
I was the same person in 2008 that preached the message Umbrella with Rihanna in the background, 250 people gave their life to Jesus on one night.
Yeah.
Like, I don't care about playing to the religious folk. I'm just saying that for the cameras. Where's the cameras? I'm saying, look, I got two eyes, one there, one over there. All right, I'm just going to send out there right to religious people. I wasn't sent for you.
Yes.
I wasn't, that's why you can't come to this church. I've got broken people in my church that I need to shepherd.
Yes.
I've got people who used to be prostitutes in my church and they need to get this message, so. Take your tithes, take it somewhere else.
Yes.
Take your King James Version somewhere else. I preach out a new Living Translation and a Message Bible, and God is still glorified.
Yes.
Just say that to the bank, amen.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Titus chapter 2.
Yes.
All right. I'm kind of sick and tired, man. I'm really serious about that, man. I get nervous. What did we say last week? We said that we are, every single one of us, we are all in the same.
Yes.
For the fact that someone like Stormzy, millions of people are going to buy his album.
Yeah. Jesus all over it. Yeah.
Look, yeah, he's got some curse words and he's got some stuff I don't agree with.
Yeah.
You know, it's not my kind of music.
Yeah.
But the fact that somebody can.
Oh, yeah.
See. We got to understand now that God has sent us to be covert agents.
Yes. Yes.
It's going to be undercover. I could imagine there's going to be a young guy somewhere downloading the album in his house, smoking a... Come on, you guys know what I'm talking about.
Yes.
All right? And he's going to air by grace for the first time in his life.
Yes. Yes.
Look, man, I'm good. Titus chapter 2. From verse 11 and an NLT Bible.
Yes, wow.
From verse 11, for the grace of God has been revealed.
Yes.
You didn't find it.
Yes, Lord.
Your religious knowledge, you didn't find it.
Yes.
Your theology degree didn't find it.
No.
It was revealed. Bringing salvation to all people. That cracker that you don't like, that you judge. That girl pregnant at 16 that you don't like. Anyway. And we are instructed to turn from godless living and sinful pleasures. We should live in this evil world with wisdom, righteousness, and devotion to God, while we look forward with hope to that wonderful day when the glory of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ will be revealed. So a greater revelation. He gave his life to free us from every kind of sin. But check this out. To cleanse us and to make us his very own people. Totally committed to doing good deeds. My assignment for part two of this great message is how to stand and walk in grace. So last week we spoke about how grace finds us and releases us and pulls us out of messy situations. But grace is not just a one-time event. Don't make a monument out of what God is doing. That's how people miss God. We make a monument, we make a denomination out of how we met God. But tell your neighbor, God ain't finished working yet. The Bible says we go from grace to grace. So the same grace that has the power to pull you out of that club. The same grace that has the power to pull you out of that bed. The same grace you're going to need to sustain you, to stand on, and to go through everything that you will go through. Amen. Tell your neighbor, his grace is sufficient. Father God, we thank you one more time and we say, be glorified in this place. We pray that you use whoever, whatever, and however you want to bring your glory to yourself, Father God. You share your glory with nobody. If you're going to use a bishop, use a bishop. If you're going to use an apostle, use an apostle. If you're going to use a crackhead, use a crackhead. If you're going to use a grime, what do you call it? Grime artist, use a grime artist. Whatever. You said if we don't do it right, you're going to raise stones. And please, God, can you keep other religious people busy? Because they're putting things on social media that's scaring people who are yet to know you. So, Father God, we just pray that you might be revealed in this place, in the hearts of every single person. Give your word weight in Jesus' name. Amen. And Jesus says, come dine with me. Amen. That's how we do. We eat the word of God. Can we turn this money to them? Thank you. Let's be seated. My goodness. God is good. Amen. I got so many whys on me, I feel strange. It's plugged up everywhere. Amen. But it's for greater purpose. Good morning, church. One more time.
Good morning.
Anyone living under grace?
Yes.
Anyone tired of grace?
No.
Anyone want more grace? Thank you, sir. Anyone want more grace?
No.
So, in Titus, we read of how Jesus Christ and his grace is revealed to us.
Yeah.
See, I don't know about you, but I don't believe that when I'm at my strongest, that's when I need his grace to be revealed.
Yeah.
I believe that it's a moment of weakness that I need his grace to come more evidently in my life.
Yeah.
Now, see, the concept of grace is not just a keynote of God's character. It is also the way we respond. We were saved by grace.
Yeah.
We must also live by grace.
Yeah.
Tell your neighbor, we've got to live by grace.
Yeah.
All right. You see, grace is the principle, is the concept that should actually motivate us, compel us.
Yeah.
It's the means that we get over situations. Come on, how many of you have been in situations where you couldn't get over yourself? Something bigger than you had to help you. Come on, man. You've lost something. You've lost someone. You've gone through a dark season.
Yeah.
And you could see when the Bible says, after you've done all to stand, stand. You know what it's saying? After you've done everything that you can do to stand and you can do no more, stand on His word, stand on His promises, and stand on His grace. When Chloe was leading worship at everyone, she's talking about how God carried. See, I came up with this new Jehovah thing a couple of years ago. I said, Jehovah carrier. I know it's not Hebrew, all right? But literally, Jehovah carries you. Come on, man. I don't know if you've been in that situation where literally someone had to just carry you. You don't know how you made it over. Everyone else lost their mind. Everyone else was broken. See, there's this nursery rhyme. You guys remember this nursery rhyme? Humpty Dumpty. Can we do a little Humpty Dumpty this morning? You guys remember it? You guys on River more than me? Can we do it? One. Wow. This is the African version? Guys, UK. Civilized. All right. 3, 2, 1. But no, there's gonna be a but there. All right, I remember years ago, I wrote my first book. It's a chapter that's actually called Humpty Dumpty. When it says that all the kings, also not the king's men, couldn't put Humpty Dumpty back together again, most of you guys put an exclamation mark. Some people put a full stop.
Yeah.
I put a comma. But God. See, a lot of us, we have been broken and nobody can put us back together again. No one can fix us. No one can. But then God came in, He pulled us out, and you are standing. Look, let's talk about, can we just be real with this? Because when you start to really understand what grace is, you understand that it is not something that you do. It is not something that you have the power to enact.
Yeah.
It is God all by Himself that says, I'm going to put my favor upon you.
Yes.
I'm going to put my hands upon you. I'm going to pluck you out and I'm going to carry you through.
Yes.
In the 21st Psalm, David said that, you know, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. You know what? You know, I did some research years ago into this. When you talk about the shadow of death, you know what it means? It means that death is all around you. Death is all around you. There, you should be dead too.
Yeah.
We're not just talking about physical death. We're talking about spiritual death, financial death, emotional death, that kind of stuff. Death was all around. The atmosphere was overwhelmed and gripped with death. But David, in the midst of that, is saying, "I will fear no evil, for you are with me. You literally, you carried me. Come on." How many of you have been in that situation where death was all around? Well, there's a voice saying to you, you should give up now. It is over now. The fat lady has sang. But the devil is a liar. I pray I'm good now to go. I don't need this no more. All right, can I end this over? You guys can hear me?
Yeah.
But David said, you know what? Because you're with me. You're carrying me. You're sustaining me. I know in this congregation and those who are watching online, I know that there are so many different issues represented right now.
Yeah. Yeah.
Even in this year alone.
Yeah. Yeah.
Come on, how many people have gone through some stuff even this year alone?
Yeah.
Yeah. Come on, man. I'm talking to the right audience, man. Yeah. But you're standing because grace.
Yeah.
Now, this is what in the book of Titus says that for the grace of God has been revealed, the revelation, bringing salvation to all people, salvaging all people.
Yeah.
And we are now instructed, now we are now being led. The word instruction means to be led or to be taught something or to be led. Not only is God teaching us, but He's also leading us.
Yeah.
Bible says those who are led by the Spirit, come on now, come on, finish it for me. Those are the sons and daughters of God. So through His grace, we have been led towards something greater.
Yeah.
And isn't this the thing that keeps you and I going? To know that there is something greater.
Yeah.
Something bigger.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm not getting any response today. Do you guys know what grace is?
Yeah.
Grace. Wow. Let me. Okay, I'm gonna try and break it down to you to so that everybody understand this. A grace encounter is something that cannot be cannot be denied.
Yeah.
And I'm gonna tell you my story a little bit. I've had many a grace encounters.
Yeah.
I had one this morning. Mm-hmm. I have one to preach to you. I have to have one. Mm. I have one every single moment of my life. Because a grace encounter is that empowering thing that comes over you, mm-hmm, that allows you to do what you have to do, mm-hmm, and to get through what you have to get through. A couple of weeks ago, we spoke about our concept of the solution is always in a problem. Mm. And on Thursday, for those who came on Thursday, we were sharing about that as well when we did worship. Mm. But you know that oftentimes God will put you in a problem.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Not for you to find a solution, not to bring you a solution, but to make you the solution.
Yeah.
That's what grace does. God says, I've given you enough. The word sufficient means that you have enough, you have adequate, you have a perfect fit of everything you need to get through what you're going through. The thing about a lot of us believers is this, that we don't believe we can get through what where God has placed us.
Yeah.
But the Bible says that he has given us everything.
Yeah.
All we have to do is open our eyes to see what God's revealing.
I'm
going to preach to the two people who are saying and amen. The rest of you guys, get your iPhone out, go through Instagram, and I will, better when it's offering time, I will talk to you. Amen. All right. But check this out. This is my first time preaching with a laptop. It's weird, right? All right. So let's break it down. The New Testament word for grace is charis. Remember I told you about it last week, right? Yeah. It focuses on a concept of provision for. It's not just a picking up from. It's not just a rescue from, but it's a provision for. It's also where we get the word charisma.
Yeah.
You know when you say someone's got charisma? Like they've got this thing that comes alive in them. They can do something. They walk into in front of an audience and they just grip the audience. You know, you're charismatic. You know what that means? It means that they've been given what is required to do what they need to do. It's called grace. It's called grace. See, some things that you go through and you endured and you survived, other people couldn't do it. Why? Because they weren't graced to do that. That's why social media, I love social media, but I also have it's kind of an love-hate relationship with social media. Because one of the things that social media does to us is that it causes us to compare ourselves. We look at how other people are living, how people are doing. Because remember, I keep telling you, man, no one's going to take a selfie of themselves looking mashup. Can I use that word mashup in church? Hey, man, I've used it too late. All right. They're not going to put that out there. People, they use filters. For some people, to put one picture up takes an hour. They go do enough squats, enough push-ups quickly, get a face done. I'm talking about the guys, by the way. Like, get everything done, everything in place, right filter, click, no, click. Keep on clicking. And then you, with yourself, scrolling through people's timeline, saying, I wish I was like that. I wish I was doing that. Oh, I wish I was a pastor. I wish I was a preacher. I wish I was this. I wish I was Chloe. You do? They said, if the thing is, people out there that you're comparing yourself to, maybe they've been graced to do what they're doing. And if you don't have that grace on your life, you're not empowered or enabled to do that. I'm telling you that, man. You will wreck yourself. Everyone says, oh, I want to be married. You know it takes grace to be married?
Not for you, though.
I'm just gonna keep looking that direction. Hey guys. But it takes grace to act right in a marriage. Come on now, man. Can't just walk into a marriage and say, you know, I want to do whatever I want. You need grace. You need grace to be revealed to you. You need grace to make sure that you, like, a small thing doesn't become a big thing. Yeah. Yeah. A to the man. Some of you need grace to be in your job. And some of you say that, you know, I want that person's job. You ain't got a grace for that. And all of you guys are missing Barack Obama now. Like, he don't miss you guys because he's having fun right now. But I know a lot of you, a lot of people, when he became president, oh, he's the Antichrist. He's the this. There's so many false prophets out there. It's ridiculous. Now we miss him. Now we miss. See, people put their mouth on the things they did. Yes, he made a lot of mistakes. He's in leadership. Anyone in leadership will make mistake. I make mistake all the time. But let me tell you something. He was grace to do what he did. If we put you in his position. See, we're too quick to put a mouth on stuff in that we don't really fully understand. We don't really understand it. See, one of the things that I always look at in my life is this, that I am probably one of the most misunderstood people in the world. And guess what? That's okay. If you met me, how old am I now? Wow. That's peak. Okay. If you met me about 17 years ago, I wouldn't be your preacher. You would look at me and say, like, oh, I want to be under his church. I want to be in his church. I want him to. No, you wouldn't do that. See, the thing about grace is grace takes you for a journey. That's why it's called grace. God's unmerited favor. Something undeserved. Something that I wasn't even looking for. Because come on, man, how many people know that sometimes sin is good? Wow. Come on. When you were living like that, when you were sinning, it felt good, right? Look at Christians that say sin, and they're like, no. Don't let me prophesy over your life right now. All right, when you were in your mess, it was good. When you were doing your stuff, it was good. But grace came in and showed you and revealed something better. Something better. That's what grace does. It always reveals something better. And that's why you must, when you look at yourself, see yourself through the eyes and lens of grace. See yourself as someone better. The reason why a lot of people, when they go through the challenging moments in life, the reason why they don't survive it is because they don't see better. They see themselves in a cave, forgetting that every cave has an exit. They say that I'm going through a tunnel, forgetting the fact that every tunnel has an exit. That's why you need the Holy Spirit to work this thing called grace out. You need the Holy Spirit to constantly remind you. Because when you can be reminded, then you can stand. When you can be reminded about the goodness of God and what He is doing, not what He's finished doing in your life yet, but what He's still doing in your life, it will allow you to stand. I was saying to the guys on Thursday, like, one of the reasons why. See, David, I keep talking about David. I meant to talk about Paul today, but I'm talking about David. Funny how things work. The reason why David, messed up as he was, crazy as he was, full of dirt as he was, the reason why God can say, I have found a man of... I told you guys that means God was looking for David. He looked around, he looked at all the prophets, he looked at all the religious folks and all the priests, but none of them did he say, I have found. Wow. And the reason why is because David, no matter how many times he flopped the show, no matter how many times he dropped the ball, God knew that he wasn't finished with him yet. God says, I have found a man after my heart. David kept running back to God. He just kept running back to God. If you can keep running back, God says, I will make something beautiful out of you. Let's journey. Let's journey. Let's journey. Not only can he make something beautiful out of you, but he can make something beautiful out of the crazy dark season you're going through. You have the grace to endure. Come on, man. I know you're a single mother and you think, are you going to make it? But God says, my grace is sufficient. You look at everyone else and everyone else has got a job and everyone else is living the fancy house. And said, no, God said, my grace is sufficient. You lost everything. You lost loved ones. But God said, my grace is sufficient because my grace that carries you. It doesn't just save you, but it's going to carry you through the toughest moments of your life. It's going to repair you. It's going to fix you. There was a song I listened to recently. It's by Israel Houghton. You guys know Israel? I know some people are putting their mouth on him as well right now. Wow. We're funny people. We're funny people. My, we're funny people. Oh, it's got a song called If Not For Your Grace. And look, listen to the words and says, grace that restores. We know what that means. Grace that redeems and means to salvage that which was lost. Grace that releases miracles. Grace releases, and this is my own little knowing it. Grace releases and is a launch pad for the miraculous. Grace releases you and releases things to you. Grace like a magnet. It's got two sides to it. Grace attracts the God things into your life and it repels the other things away from you. Things that don't even come near you, don't even see it. That's why it's important that every time that you learn to be grateful. Because grace literally put his hands out and blocked some things from coming towards you. Oh, man. I will see that. It also said grace that repairs visions and dreams. You know, life can just kill your visions and dreams. People's behavior and people putting their mouth in your stuff can just diminish your dreams. Come on, how many people you've second guessed who you are in God because someone spoke. Come on, man, come on. You shared a dream and idea with somebody and said, oh, you? Oh, you're going to do it? You're going to do it? But that song says, grace that repairs dreams and visions. Some of us, we've kept our dreams and visions under the bed because we don't think that it's gonna work out. Come on, everyone else is doing great stuff. My little stuff, what's gonna achieve? Can I please take you back to the book of Matthew? There was a young boy who I told you guys a couple of weeks ago was probably an orphan. All right? He came with two fish. Or as the King James Version said, two fishes. Bad English, but it's still good. Two fish and five loaves. He came with that which was counted out. But in the hands of Jesus, great things came out of it. There was an abundance that came out of it. Same thing with the woman, the widow. Remember the widow? She said, I have nothing left apart from this jar of oil. But that jar of oil paid all her debts, got her sons out of slavery, and redeemed her. Come on, man. Like, see, grace will take a small thing. Grace will take a nothing. I'm making something great and beautiful. That same grace was going to take you through the toughest moments of life. It's what's going to help you to see beyond the dark things, the dark clouds of life right now. It's grace. It's going to give you the charisma. Come on, have you seen someone dancing? You say, wow, they dance so gracefully. See, grace has a rhythm, it has a beauty, it has an elegance about it. You know, come on, don't look at me. This is not elegance. But you can imagine. When you see like the ballroom dancers, not this kind of like, you know, this, what do people do nowadays? They, what's that new one? Like, someone say, like, what's that? That's a dance? Come on, I feel sorry for this generation. Seriously, man. Like, that's a dance. Like, what was that called? Dab. dab. No, this is dabbing. This is a dab. That's a dab. All right. But when you see the kind of bore, or you know, I like to listen to merengue and bachata. You know, you guys know that kind of music? No, you don't. All right. You know, them kind of music where you got like, you got to move the waist and the legs. You know, do you know what I'm saying to you? There's an elegance about it. Like, that's graceful. When it's done right, it's graceful. It's a beauty to behold. Come on, how many of you guys been to weddings and see your uncles dance? It's always the uncles, I don't know why. Note to self, when you get married, don't invite uncles. Just them to leave the presence at the door, amen? But when someone's dancing gracefully and they're moving great, it's attractive. It attracts people. People talk about it. People take out their phones and they take pictures of it. Imagine you and I, we choose to live every moment of our life gracefully. That you go through the tough times and you go through the valley of the shadow of death gracefully. Within the next 2 weeks, we're getting ready to lay to rest one of our dear sisters, Amina. We were praying for her, we're believing God. I went to the hospital and you know she was laughing, she was trying to find a way to serve. I told you guys that, you know, one of the things that she wanted to do was to get better and come to church and serve. So she passed away, and that hurts. But you know, do you know what buffered the pain? Is the fact that through a sickness, through all the time she was bedridden, through all the time when the doctor said, you know, she held on to God.
Yes.
She believed God. She was evangelizing.
Oh, yes.
Remember the day when I went to go see her? She was saying, Pastor, no, pray for that woman. Pray. She wasn't asking for prayer for herself.
Wow, yeah.
The old war, she was saying we should pray for the other people, then to come to Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
See, I know where she's going to end up because she ended it gracefully.
Oh, yeah.
That I left the hospital room, I'm thinking, she preached to me. That I'm looking at her life and her death, saying, wow.
Oh, wow, wow.
That can only be God. See, we have to learn to live life where people have to say, wow. That can only be God. Now, I know you're going through some situations, I know. But come on. Come on, tell your neighbor, come on. Let God have his way in your life. Let God have the sovereign rule. Let God have the right place in your life, in your mind. Because when the world sees it, let me tell you, that is bigger than any message, any sermon. Come on, man. See, I like... I don't know if it's the right thing to say, but it's too late now. My mind's already deposited it, so I have to say it. See, the way my... Guys, pray for my mind, you know, guys. When I ask it not to work, it works, and it says things to me. And then I have to then blurt it out. So if it comes out wrong, blame my mind. So I have this thing in my mind that... Like, I want a church full of people that have been through something. Can I tell you the reason why? Because, and that's why I love you guys, because last week I preached about, well, talking about grace, but I spoke to you guys about the girl in the red dress. Now, you guys took that and you guys were like, wow, it is still theologically sound. Other people were saying, I think, wow, why are you talking about a girl in a red dress for? Is someone, he's talking about flirting, all that kind of stuff. If people haven't been through anything, they will find something to criticize. Some of you guys, you're giving up on your dreams and your hopes and the things that you're going through because you're listening to people who've not been through a third of what you've had to go through in life. Can you please be careful about that, please? Imagine if our church is full of every single person, every single sin that's known to man. Do you think our church would be better or worse? Some people can't open their mouth. It will be better. Shall I tell you why? Because then when the word goes forth, it gets into good soil. The easiest people for me to preach to, guys, are unbelievers, Muslims, they're the easiest people for me to preach to. Because I don't have to impress them. I don't have to impress them. Yeah, or seek their approval. Don't need to. All I need to do is tell them the truth of the power of grace. And they want to know some more. Like, we often bring people into our church that I meet when I go out to do my speaking engagements outside. I bring them to our church, and they don't believe in what we believe. They don't believe in Jesus. But then they send me messages on Facebook and Instagram or emails, and they say to me, PG. And the fact that they call me pastor, I'm like, wow, do you know what that means? But anyway, they said, okay, if I try this thing out, can you be my pastor? I'm like, yeah, why not? I said, why did you ask that? They said, well, because we've walked into other establishments before and we wanted the ground to open up and swallow us up, basically. Because the message that was being spoken was showing that God wanted to condemn us and that we were going to die. Not that we had a second chance to make it right. Guys, another evidence of grace in your life is how you speak.
Oh, yeah.
How you speak matters. Do you speak with grace? The Bible says that the power of life and death is in the tongue. You have a choice in every moment to either speak gracefully to somebody, tactfully, timely, lovingly. You're not going to get the same mess. You know, come on. Look, I'm Nigerian, right? And I've got uncles that shout. All right, they shout. They want to say good morning. Good morning! And that's love. Until I met my wife, I mean, Caribbeans, they're a bit more refined.
Yeah.
Especially the ones from the smaller islands. All right? Because it's only then I realized that you could say good morning in lower decibels. And still have the same meaning and power. Now, I've got these uncles that they will have to shout everything. That when you're on the phone to them, you have to put the phone down. You don't have to put the speaker on. Just leave it down and you can hear everything that they're saying. Now, when someone's going through a tragic situation or a trauma, those voices are wrong for that season. Do you understand what I'm saying to you?
Yeah.
What I'm trying to convey to us is this, that why is it that we're trying to tell people about Jesus, but we feel like we have to get a megaphone and shout? Let me tell you something. I'm back to this again. That grammar artist is more powerful right now in God's hands than anyone with a megaphone shouting condemnation at anybody. More powerful. More powerful. Whether you agree or not, that's the truth. More powerful. God has probably told him that I will make something. Did he listen to our pastor where his mom is praying for him? That's me. God prayed. Like my mom, I had a praying mother. I'm the same guy at the age of 19. I had a gun in a shoebox in my bedroom. But the grace that flowed through the power of praying mother allowed me to put a gun down. Do you hear what I'm saying to you? My life could have turned out totally, totally different. Your life could have turned out totally different. But look what God is doing with you right now. So when you speak to people, don't speak to them as someone who's arrived. That you were born in a manger with Jesus. Let them know that you've been through some stuff. And let it be evident in your speech.
Yes.
You know what? I want more of us to be like the Holy Spirit. I know you can't be the Holy Spirit, but be filled with the Holy Spirit so that when people see you, you're like the Holy Spirit. That one of the characteristics of the Holy Spirit is that it comes alongside. Can we start coming alongside sinners? Everyone's leaving the church now. Oh dear. Pastor just said, come alongside sinners.
Wow. Come alongside each other then, isn't it?
It's too late now because you're already sitting next to yourself anyway. So, all right. But can we come alongside somebody who doesn't know about this thing yet? Can we come alongside somebody who doesn't know all the Hebrew names of God yet? Can we come alongside them? Can we tell them that God did it for me? And he will surely do it for you. Can we come alongside somebody who's about to commit suicide and said, he changed my world. He can change yours too. This is what grace does, man. We must be grace-driven in our Christianity. We must be grace-driven. I know some of us now, we're at the stage right now, we are super saved. That's not in the Bible, by the way. But we are super saved right now that everyone else smells to us. Like recently, I'm like, okay, look, you know, I'm getting older now, you know, I'm getting older, you know, I'm not old, but older, praise God. All right. And, you know, some of you guys, you know, we did this photo shoot, you know, and I was refining that photo shoot, right? I'm like, man, I look one of some American preachers, like. Then I come to realize, I'm like, okay, that's opened doors for me to that world now. And it's a good thing. Yeah, yeah, they clap for you, they do that kind of stuff. But I said, hold on. I'm not sent to them. I'm really not sent to them because I'm uncomfortable with them. I mean, they pay a lot of money, but I'm uncomfortable with them. I'm like, I'm going to get back into my Tim's. Okay, I'm going to get back to my skinny jeans. I'm going to get back to who I know. So that I can preach to people like me. We might never hear this gospel message being preached. I tell people, look, I don't want to be on TBN. The opportunity came and it went. I'm like, thank you, Jesus. I don't want to be on God Channel. Because the people who are going to watch the God Channel on TBN, they're not the people I'm sent to. I know what I've been given the grace for. God allows me to speak to gang members and they put guns down. All right? I can speak to crack, people on crack and they put the drugs down. That's who I'm sent to. I'm not sent to the guys who are going to debate with me. Oh, no, I was reading the Message Bible today. By the way, let's go to the National Message Bible. 2 Corinthians 12 from verse 7. Because of the extravagance of those revelations, remember it was revealed. And so I wouldn't get a big head. Oh, my. Do you know why I love this Message Bible? I was given the gift of a handicap to keep me in constant touch with my limitations. Satan's angels did his best to get me down. See, not everything that's against you is from the enemy. Sometimes God will leave some stuff in your life, but it's up to you whose commentary you receive based on that thing. It says right there, the devil tried to get me down because of what God gave me. God can take some stuff away from your life and he can say to you, look, I'm doing something bigger. I'm working this out. But the enemy will come and say, you know what, give up, man. God ain't for you, man. He's messed you up. This is what Paul's saying. The devil came, Satan's angel, the devil came, did his best to bring me down. What he in fact did was push me to my knees. No danger then of walking around high and mighty. At first, I didn't think of it as a gift and beg God to remove it. Three times I did that and then he told me this. Come on, how many of you are going through suffering and say, God, take it away. Don't do it no more. Say, God, give me the grace to endure this. There's a lesson every season and God is with you in every season. Come on, somebody, amen. It says, my grace is enough. It is all you need. Don't call a friend. It's all you need. Wow. My strength, catch this now. My strength comes into its own in your weakness. Once I heard that, I was glad to let it happen.
Wow.
It's gone from asking for it to be taken away to it. Now I'm glad.
Yes.
Come on, do your best. Because
yes,
God, if you promise me that your grace is enough for what I'm going through,
yes,
bring it on.
Yes.
Because let me tell you something. After you've walked on a journey with God, what comes out of it is sweet.
Oh.
After God has finished cooking everything up together for you, that's what the Bible says, for we know that all things work together for good. Everything, because God is with you. And began appreciating the gift.
Yeah.
It was a case of Christ's strength moving in on my weakness. Now I take limitations in stride and with good cheer. These limitations that cut me down to size, abuse, accidents, opposition, bad breaks. Come on. How many of you got that word before? You've been abused? Come on. Accidents, opposition. Come on. Bad breaks. I just let Christ take over.
Wow.
I just let Christ take over. And so the weaker I get, the stronger I become. See, grace will allow you to look at life and your experience differently. When you look at life through the lens of grace, you won't be so hard on yourself. Your prayers will change. So rather than you going to God and saying, God, why are you not doing this for me? Why are you leaving me? You get to a place where you start saying to yourself, Lord, I know that this is working out for my good. I know that when all is said and done, a greater revelation of who you are and what you can do is manifested. This is what grace can do. I want to speak to somebody in this room where you've had enough. Come on, you've lost everything that you could have lost. You've been squashed and oppressed and in ways, like just multiple ways. Like you've reached the end of the rope. You feel like your life is stuck, is literally stuck between a rock and a hard place. You feel like you're constantly climbing mountains and there's always a new mountain. You overcome this mountain and here comes another one. You're trying to get a break. You're trying to start a business. You're trying to make this relationship work. And you're like, God, are you even listening to me? Now, I'm not a cliche Christian. I don't believe in that. But I will say this to you. And because this is God's word. I am enough for you. I am simply enough for you. And oftentimes, God will allow us to go through those times so that we can fully comprehend where our source, who our source is and where our resource comes from.
Yeah. Yes.
I'm reminded of Peter when Jesus compelled Peter to walk on water.
Yeah.
See, at that moment, Jesus gave him the grace to walk on water. Because grace is an enabler. It enables you to do something that you can't, that's beyond your natural self.
Yeah.
As he was walking, he had his eyes on Jesus and he was good. It knew would call them and it knew would sustain them. But the moment it took its eyes off the sustainer, it began to sink. The moment that we forget that we are in this and doing life by His grace and His grace alone, life will overwhelm us so powerfully that it feels like we're sinking. So in order to avoid that, do me a favor. Constantly, you understand what I'm saying to you? You can't be you and I, we can't be sin-free by ourselves. In fact, for a lot of us, we run to sin. All right, some of you ladies, remember when the guys just go, and you run across the road? I hope none of you guys did it. Like, oi, and like, yeah, me. That's your name. All right? But that's how love us. We're out to sin. We just run to sin. But it's the grace of God that says, you know what? Mm-mm. There's something better. There is something greater. There's something more abundant. There's a way to me than this thing called sin. Now, I don't know how many people in this room, you have an addiction. Can we just keep it real? Can we keep it real? I know you guys listen to Stormzy too, all right? Let's keep it real, all right? Anyone have an addiction in this room? Just raise your hands up. This is going to be the weirdest thing I've ever done as a church. Some people are not going to be real with it. It's cool. Anyone believe that we're in a grace environment and they want to say, look, I have an addiction to something? Thank you, guys. Put your hands down. Anyone we just lied? Rest of you, put your hands up. Every single one of us, we're addicted to something. Some of you are addicted to church, and that's not a good thing. That ain't a good thing. Some of you are addicted to your ego and your pride. Some of you are addicted to that ex that left you and broke your heart. Some of you, you're still addicted to your past. You're addicted to the word that your father spoke over your life that was negative. You're still addicted to that. Addiction is an attachment. Everybody's attached to something. You know, your addiction might not look like my addiction. My addiction might not look like your addiction. But I promise you, we are all in the same sinking boat. I'm going to ask that question one more time. How many of you are addicted to something? You got to raise those hands. We can't be healed unless we're truthful. Grace only comes into fruition when we admit our weaknesses. My strength is made perfect in your weakness. And the reason why I ask us to put our hands up is this. Look, check this out. We all need is grace to keep doing what we're doing. We all need His grace to get over what's trying to get over us. We need it each and every day. When we look, I think I've been telling you last week that some of the chapters I'm writing my new book, I told you guys about I Can't Swim. Remember I told you guys last week? One of the other chapters is this, that everything changed the day I took a selfie. Very long chapter, but when you read it, you like it. Everything changed the day I took a selfie. The day I look at myself, I realize that I can't put my mouth on anyone else's life. The day I look to myself, I realize that I can't judge you where you are right now. Everything changed. Because I realized that in that selfie, even though just me, but I see you and me, I see me and you, we're all in the same sinking boat. But guess what? When we put our lives in the hands of the maker of heaven and earth, He has this power. He has this power and ability to remold us and remake us into His ideal. He can meet me in my addictions. He's not scared of my addictions. He can come into my dark place. Do you guys know that God is not scared of the dark? Come on, you might be afraid of the dark, but God ain't afraid of the dark. Because He's light. And light always overpowers darkness. So in that dark situation right now, just invite the light into your situation. May you stand for me, please. And I want to pray for all of us that are addicted to something. I didn't say all of you. I said all of us. They're addicted. It's a good stretch, right? Come on, where am I addicted, brothers and sisters? Just raise those hands up. Can we pray this moment? Can we just come forward? I'm not going to get no one to pray for you because someone to pray to him. They're in this too. Just you guys just come forward and let's have a quick board meeting. All right, let's have a quick board meeting with Jesus. Because when grace speaks, grace doesn't say, wow, look what you're doing. Grace just says, me too. I get it. I've been there, or I'm still there right now. And what we want to do, we want to receive all of God in our lives, man. And in moments like this, this is not the best time to spectate. It's not the best time to spectate. God's desire is for every single person to be set free. And he has that power over it, man. Come on. I want to get over some things. I want his grace to help me get through this. To get through my dark seasons, to get through my wilderness, to get through my brokenness, to get through my addictions. I still believe there's still more coming. The thing about God is that when God grips you, and that's why I entitled this series Gripped, is that when he grips you, he never lets you go. We might let go of the grip, but he never lets go of the grip. There's nothing that you can do that can make God stop loving you. There's nothing that you can do that can make God stop making his grace available to you. You and I, we might choose not to operate and live in his grace, but he won't stop making it available to you. Now, I want to serve notice to the enemy today. Because I know for many of us, the enemy has had us bound, he's had us castrated and bound in the craziest of things. And in those moments, he's spoken to us. And he said, look where you are. Look how you're living. Look what you're doing. Look what's happening to you. And for a lot of us, we've listened to that lie. And we've allowed that lie to become the commentary of our lives. So we deal with low self-esteem. We deal with depression. We feel oppressed. We have voices in our mind tell us to do things that we know as a child of God we shouldn't, or we don't need to. I'm going to remind you right now. God said it. My grace is sufficient. My grace is perfect for your particular situation. It is perfect for your particular addiction. I have enough grace to pull you out. I have enough grace to carry you. Your God is strong. And he's not afraid of the dark. For those of us in the front, I want to lift up your hands, please. Just in surrender. This is our board meeting, guys. All right, this is our board meeting. Can you start speaking over that situation right now? Start speaking over it. Start praying over it. God, by your grace, I am set free. I can't do it by myself, but you are my enabler. You empower me. You endow me with everything I need to make it through. God, I am going to break through this. I'm going to break through oppression, depression. I'm gonna break through that lustful addiction. I'm gonna break through gossip. I'm gonna break through all these things that's happening in my life. I'm gonna break free and break through from the lies of the enemy. My life is not over. In fact, my life has just started. Everything's been made new. In Jesus, I have a fresh start. Hope will rise again. I will live again. Oh, if God be for me, nothing could be against me. Come on, start speaking over it. Start speaking over it. Speak over it. Speak over it. Come on, come on, come on, church. Come on, come on. I want you to speak over it. God is doing a new thing in your life. He's doing a new thing through you and for you. Come on, I want you to believe in this power. I want you to believe in his abilities. Believe that you will make it. Believe that even though you're struggling right now, that you will make it. You will be sustained. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. People might see my life as damaged goods, but God has power to salvage that which was damaged. He has that power, he has the ability. Come on, God, I need more of your grace. I need more of your grace. I need more of your grace. More of your grace, more of your power. More of your spirit. Now, what I want you to do now, I want you to pair up with somebody. Pair up with somebody. Find somebody and pair up with them. We're going to pray together. That's for everybody else as well, please. Wherever you are, pair up with somebody. Pair up with somebody. I want you to ask them this. I want you to ask them, what are you open that God would do in your life in this season? What's that one major thing that you're hoping that God would do for you? Come on, be specific with it. Come on, this is an atmosphere of faith. We're believing God for miracles. We're believing God for the supernatural. Yes, God. I want us to loose those hands right now, believing that God has answered our prayer. But what we're going to do, we're going to worship. I've asked the team just to take this song again, please. We're just going to worship. I want you, as a person who is standing on grace, none of your own power, none of your own strategies, but on grace, I want us to worship with this song that we've never worshiped before. I want us to throw away every constraint, everything that's restraining you, every thought in your mind that's trying to stop you from worshiping, every worry, every anxiety. I want you to get rid of it right now. Every guilt, get rid of it right now. Be like David, keep running back to God, keep running back to God, keep running back to God. We're going to take this song and we're going to believe that God is going to make something beautiful. Something beautiful, something beautiful out of you and I. You ready, church? Let's do this. Just for the next few moments, let's just do this. I feel it strong in my heart. Let's just do this. Come, let's lift those voices.
I give it all to you, God.
Hey, family. Thank you once again for tuning into today's message. We hope you were blessed by the message on grace. And we hope that from now on, you can start seeing God's grace in every area of your life, in the good times and the bad times. That knowing that God's grace is made perfect in time of your weakness. Now, as a church, we want to ask you if you consider making a one-time donation or a continued donation to our ministry. Our hope is to spread this hope message and this gospel message of Jesus around the world and to touch as many people as far as possible. So would you stand with us? Would you partner with us? The link to make a donation is www.trclondon.org/giving. You can make a one-time gift or you can make a continuous gift. And we want you to consider joining us on a Sunday morning if you're in the London area. So if you are anywhere in London, we would love to have you. We're based right in the heart of London's East End, in a cinema screen. We're based at the Cineworld Cinema in Hertzmere Road in Canary Wharf. Wherever you are, we'd love to have you. So God bless you. We hope to see you soon. And please share this message, subscribe to our channel, and let as many people as possible know about what God is doing and understand the message of grace. We love you, and God is for you. God bless.